It's a pleasure to be here. I had been here 3 years back also. So some of you, I think, were there last time also. I met at least 2-3 who were there last time. So it's really good to be here. This is a, I think, very powerful forum. And I don't think too many institutes of higher learning in India have such a forum. I have been to many IITs, IIMs, other institutions, even in Bengal, which is the, you know, turf, home turf of the Ramakrishna movement. Even there, I, you know, when I come to Chennai and South India, other places in South India, I think this vibration of inspiration is much more stronger in the youth as compared to in other parts. So it's really remarkable. I think only IIT Kanpur has a Vivekananda Samiti, which has, you know, comparably vibrant tradition of, say, inspirational talks and activities built around the theme of Swamiji. So my, you know, congratulations and best wishes for the continued success of this forum. So friends, we'll leave some time for question and answers also. So my initial talk I'll make slightly short so that we'll have more time for your questions. Since we started a bit late, so we'll make up for that. So my work you have seen a bit through this, so I won't speak much about, you know, the domain aspects, the operational aspects of work, but more about, you know, the inspiration part. And my entire inspiration comes from, you know, the Ramakrishna Vivekananda movement. So I am an initiated disciple of Swami Ranganathananji, and whatever like has been done through me, so definitely it would not have been possible at all had I not been connected with the Ramakrishna movement, and this inspiration hadn't been there. So I owe everything to, you know, the ethos and tremendous fund of inspiration which the Ramakrishna tradition, Ramakrishna Vivekananda movement has. So, but very briefly I'll touch upon, you know, I'll update about the work since this film was slightly old. And I'll speak a bit about the initial, very initial part, how I started, because there, I think that may be of some interest to you, because there the, you know, motivational, inspirational part comes into play when I actually started and initial days of setting up. So now, like my organization Parivar, it runs a residential institution about which you had heard, but we have now set up many other institutions also. In Madhya Pradesh also we are running now many day boarding centers, and one big residential setup is coming in Madhya Pradesh. Similarly in Jharkhand also we are setting. So this another dimension, this day boarding centers, meal cum education programs, which are non-residential but still have a lot of engagement with the children. So many such centers are coming up. So anyway, like that had started from last year. That will surely build up in scale in time to come. And at the same time, the free residential institution completely. All our activities are targeted towards extremely impoverished children and are completely free. So this Parivar residential institution, which has currently 1600 residential children, this is also scaling up. This will likely to be around 3,000 children in maybe 3 years' time from now. And other centers, as I said, they are also coming up. So when I was, from my introduction, you heard that I was a B.Tech from IIT Kharagpur. My early schooling had happened in Bhopal, where my father was in the civil service in Madhya Pradesh. And then after B.Tech, I worked for 1 year in Infosys. So my graph was just like, you know, not too much to distinguish from most of my batchmates at that time. So I also went to Infosys, getting a job placement at IIT. And then after 1 year, again appearing for CAT, for IIM entrance. I came to IIM Calcutta. So I should mention that was, you know, I mean, we used to appear in a number of competitive exam for the sake of sake of successfully cracking that exam, say if like GRE also I appeared, or say IIM entrance and all that. So it was not, everything was not with the idea that only in this line a career will be built. So it was more of, you know, I mean, I think a quest for some quenching this achievement, thirst for achievement also, which, you know, competitive exams have a kick. So till that level, till that stage, I also continued like that. So I came to IIM not with any concrete ideas of, say, of doing MBA or going into a career, say, like in finance or consulting or investment banking or, you know, marketing. These days, students who go into such institute, they have a very, you know, very, very clear-cut ideas even before entering, that this is the field in which they would want to build their career. But I thought that, okay, it will be a change. I had already worked for 1 year in Infosys. I thought it will be a change, and I'll also get some more time to explore what exactly I want to do long term. So with these ideas I came. But within a few months in IIM, I somehow lost, you know, inspiration for any mainstream corporate career which IIMs were preparing students for. And I could foresee what kind of, you know, career I am likely to have later on. Because like we used to have this many corporate talks or pre-placement talks. I think like two of you, I'm getting a bit disturbed. Yeah. So there used to be many corporate talks, pre-placement talks, etc. We used to have summer placement, so there also companies used to come. So many executives who had spent, say, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, they used to come and attend, you know, I mean, give such kind of talks, presentation. So somehow I never saw any role models in most of them, like in the sense that role models for me, I thought that would, after 15 or 20 years, I would like to be a person like them, not having a career like them. That was never, you know, my mind didn't operate like that. I thought, would I want to be like a, you know, a person like them after 20 years? As a person, because I thought, you know, I mean, I had exposure in some, you know, reading even before that, say about the Swami Vivekananda or other, many other icons which we have in society, say the independence movement, Gandhi, other social workers, humanitarian workers. So this kind of inspirational figures, I related more to them, and somehow I felt that as a person, even these people are not growing with time. Somehow my feeling was this. They may be a top executive in a company having spent 20 years, but as a person, I didn't find much to, you know, get inspired by. So this was one, you know, a big thing, because I thought that I am entering, if I have to proceed into that environment, then I am committing to a culture and environment where there won't be too many peer inspirational sources or senior inspirational sources, even among seniors, etc., in the whole field. So I thought that I would want to do a work which is in line with this personal aspiration of, you know, making some progress in leading a life of values, and whatever values we hold dear. Everyone, I think, holds certain values dear. So having a chance to build on those values and choosing that kind of work which is in line with that value system, so that those values can be developed. So this was the idea with which I began to think that I am not, you know, going into a corporate career. So I opted out of the placement process at that time. And after that, I many months, around six, eight months, I did field work. Like I used to visit many organizations, visit some either social workers or, you know, other persons who were doing some original work. Okay, so some social activists also I met, some institution builders. So this was an exploration. Now, even after that, I found that even in the social sector, there are so many things which can be done, and many things require a huge domain competence. For example, if one has to say successfully impact lives of say farmers, then certain domain competence is needed in that. Okay, you need to have a certain know-how, say maybe of agriculture or watershed techniques, or say what are the challenges in say rain-fed areas or drought-prone areas, all that. If one is working in environment, again a certain domain know-how is needed. Now, I did not have any domain know-how, okay, of any of these things. So I thought that I don't have any, you know, any great intellectual idea to build on. My organization cannot be built on an intellectual idea if I have to work or start an organization. So what to do? That was the thing. So I then felt that it's not necessary that a work is built on any intellectual idea. It can be very well based on a feeling. Okay. And here, you know, the literature of Swami Vivekananda, that I found resonance there. Because Swamiji says that heart is the seat of all power. There is a sentence by Swamiji, heart is the seat of all power. All learning, intellectual equipments are all superficial before the power of the heart. So this was, I also thought that this feeling, if we can base a work on the feeling, so I thought that if I start working, I mean create a setup where children who are completely, you know, who don't have much family support, lacking in family support, homeless children, orphan children, children from, many girl children vulnerable to trafficking, etc., from red light areas. I had exposure to these fields because I used to visit many organizations which used to engage with this. Children living in railway platforms, moving in trains. So these kind of children, if we create a setup where loving and caring will be the primary value. And I'll also take other, you know, people who will join, they will actually like this loving, caring, that will be manifested. And that, so therefore the whole organization will be based on a feeling and a value rather than a great, you know, different intellectual idea, something which hasn't been thought about or hadn't been executed before. Actually, there is nothing in my work which is intellectually, you know, extraordinary, nothing at all. Everyone, you know, every mother or every parent or every housewife is actually doing work on their scale, which I am trying to do through my organization. So intellectually there is nothing fancy involved. Whole idea is to maintain the purity of, you know, feeling in execution. When you execute, first to, you know, feel purely, selflessly, and create a culture where lots of other people also, you know, are on the same wavelength of that feeling, and execute that, manifest that in form of an organization. So my organization, therefore, in one line can be said that it's an expression and manifestation of, you know, feeling, sentiment and value of love, care and selfless service, servicefulness, than say any big intellectual idea. So with this I started with three children, then tried to, this vision I tried to continuously impart to other people who joined, volunteers or workforce. We call them sevavratis. And with this it continued. So I wrote appeals to first IIM alumni. They used, requesting for just awareness, or, you know, if possible they can visit, or they can spread word. So sometimes they used to contribute some, you know, very humble figures, because I suggested only very small figures. At that time scale was also small, and I also want, I did not want to be dependent on a few big sources of financial support. I wanted to, wanted that to have a very broad base of supporters, even though the magnitude of support from one particular source was less. So with this idea, for many years, it actually ran only on individual supporter base. And with time, these individuals, since many of these individuals were working in some big companies, they were moving in certain circles from where they could connect more people as well as institutional support in form of corporates, etc. So with time, such institutional support, corporate support also started flowing. But what I mean to say is that it was always striking a relationship with the individual, because it's the individual which does all the work in the whole world. Even behind any institution, any company, there are individuals only. So this was the method which I followed. Now, a few things I'll say. One thing is that I also, when I was starting, this question I asked myself, that will I be able to do this work irrespective of the scale for whole of my life? Because many times what happens is that we are energized or motivated by, say, certain future possible milestones which we perceive as success. Say, if we start a company, if we engage in a business, start a company, we think that, okay, right now it's, say, its turnover is 10 lakh, how can it become 5 crore or 50 crore? These possible milestones are on our radar, thought radar, and they energize us. That's the normal way of motivation. So I call it the ambition dimension of motivation. But I felt that there is a deeper, you know, aspect of motivation which is not related to the milestones. I call it the mission dimension of motivation. There you are in a work just because you feel this is your swabhava. You are expressing yourself through that work. So even if, like, it's not that those milestones are, you know, attracting you and energizing you, definitely in day-to-day planning we need milestones. We also get inspiration. That remains a source of, you know, motivation. But it cannot be the only source of motivation. And we are used to, all our lives, we are used to actually this ambition, milestone-based motivation only. If we look at all our lives, right from our childhood, like if suppose we were getting 80% marks, our next aims put before us were that how to get 90%, 95%. If we got fifth rank, then how to come in top three. So it's the normal approach. Nothing wrong with that. But for, you know, a much deeper stratum of inspiration, motivation is what is based on the mission, that you feel that you are, this is your life. You were born to do this. So I asked myself that, you know, in my initial months, I had rented a building which was good enough only for 30 children. And I thought that for first 3 years, I'll run in this. And then, you know, let's see how it proceeds. If after 3 years, I'm able to get a land, etc. Though eventually, like, I could get it much earlier. But when I was starting, I told myself that even for whole of my life, if I have to take care, run this small setup only, say of 30 children for whole of my life, 20 years, 25 years, will I get, you know, frustrated, or will any doubts be there in my mind that I, you know, these notions of success or failure come? That is the most important. Notions of success or failure. If you are dependent on milestone-based motivation, then notions of success and failure are bound to bind us. Whereas, you know, if we are doing the work just for the sake of that work, milestones are achieved in course of time on their own. Whatever milestone, doesn't matter. But what you are doing is working. So actually, so one wonderful, you know, sentence from Swamiji is there. I think he said this during the times when there was big plague in Calcutta in 1899, and when he was, you know, when he inspired lots of young people, many of them were young monks and brahmacharis in the nascent Ramakrishna order at that time. So he said that, you know, success is not our goal, death in the cause is. Okay, so what is success? It's not that at one point you reach the end post and you get success and you are called successful or you will be happy that you are successful. It's never like that. Okay. In great, any such great missions, there is no end line. So you, for whole of your life, dying in the cause, dying in the sense that, you know, mean whole of, spending whole of your life and eventually your life ends, but you are always in the pursuit of that cause, continued pursuit. So this actually, you know, had a lot of resonance with me. I also at that time felt that, yes, for whole of my life, I'm ready to, you know, even this work, which is, you know, whatever scale, small scale or whatever, these small, large, these are, you know, perceptions. But I'll be happy and I'll be fulfilled and I'll continue to do whatever be the case, continue to do this for whole of my life, irrespective of the milestone achieved. When this feeling I got, then I, you know, really got much more convinced that, you know, a deeper level of inspiration is there. So that was the initial part. And at that time, we of course like books written or talks by Swamiji, they of course are there. But one particular book called Monastic Disciples of Swami Vivekananda, that I got a chance to read just when I was starting this work. It has 13 biographical profiles of the disciples of Swami Vivekananda. Not too many of you would have heard their names, okay. Only like people who are very closely connected with the Ramakrishna order, they know, okay. So their lives were extraordinary. Through that I got a tremendous light of what Swamiji, you know, would have been. Through their eyes, how their lives were transformed. It had particularly, like, I recommend that book to, you know, all of you. It's such a powerful book. Particularly lives of, you know, a few monks, Swami Kalyananji, who set up the Sevashram at Kankhal near Haridwar, which is now a big hospital. How his story. Swami Nishchayanand, who was his associate there. Swami Shubhanand, who established the Varanasi Sevashram. So such extremely inspiring life stories of people who had come in touch with Vivekananda. Maybe met very briefly in some cases. Very briefly. Maybe for a few hours. And maybe with only a few sentences exchanged. But what tremendous impact, you know, Vivekananda had on them. Like to Kalyananand, he said that, you know, he was from East Bengal and he was sent to Rishikesh area with the line that, you know, you never come back here to Bengal. Forget Bengal and go and die there. This is my, you know, blessing. So it's extraordinary blessing. Have we ever heard of such a blessing that you are blessing someone to go and die there? So this created a tremendous impact. So I, from that time onwards, at that time definitely I thought that, you know, mean I would want to lead a life like that. If Vivekananda had been before, you know, before us, then what would he expect? What kind of life he would expect, say, me to live? That is the question I put before me. Okay, and I try to bring that question. I can't say that I've, you know, solved that in the way, ideal way. There is no ideal way. Okay, and, you know, being up to such an ideal is very difficult. But at least I can say that, you know, I try to be up to that, at least with whatever limitations, okay, that what Swamiji would have wanted from, say, the Indian youth of his time, or if he would have come across people like us, what would he have advised? So this was a very, you know, important thing, a very transformative thing, because after that I decided many things which are, you know, which impacted work, which were personal decisions, but impacted work. For example, I also, you know, though I did not join, since I started my work, I could not have the opportunity, you know, or blessedness to, say, formally join the Ramakrishna order. But I thought that, okay, I'll remain single and work. So I, that became resolved, that I would not, you know, get into married life, etc. But these things, though they were, you know, personal decisions, they were highly, you know, influencing, very, very influential in my work, because my whole way of life after that changed. The kind of work that I was doing, that changed. Okay. So it went into the design of the institution also in some way, surely. The culture of the institution, etc. I'm not sure what, you know, I mean, it would have been had this not been the case. Like, my life would have been a bit different. I'm not sure whether my work would have remained the same. Because, you know, there is nothing like personal life and work life. At the end of the day, these are very closely related and impact each other. Particularly when we talk of, you know, I mean, when it calls going beyond the self. Okay. Here it's written unselfishness is God. Okay. So wherever it calls for going beyond the self, then definitely you have to, that tremendous energy is needed. It's not natural. Natural means, you know, I mean, in some sense, natural means, you know, thinking of lower self, smaller self, basically. Smaller self, lower self, okay, getting bound by it. But Vivekananda had meant an extraordinary statement. You know, I reflect on it very often. He said, all progress is unnatural. Okay, all progress is unnatural. So when we say that, oh, this is natural, these instincts are natural, okay. Yeah, of course they are natural, but all progress is unnatural, Swamiji says. It's the nature of a thing to, you know, sink in water, but a ship doesn't sink. It moves, remaining afloat. It's natural to defy gravity, but aeroplanes do that. It's natural not to defy gravity. To fall is the nature, but aeroplanes defy the law of gravitation. So all progress, I mean, Swami Vivekananda says, he said that what am I hearing these days? That, you know, I mean, it's natural, move, do whatever is natural, everything natural is good, all these things. Don't you know all progress is unnatural? He says this. It takes a lot of reflection, actually, to, you know, grasp this. So this also, like going beyond the self, it's in some ways it's you know, if you talk of lower nature, then it's unnatural. If you talk of lower nature or smaller nature. But in the, you know, Vedanta says that the true essence of person is divine, he is divine, he is not this mind and body. Then of course, it's perfectly natural to be selfless. If you talk on this Vedantic idea, okay, that a human being is not mind and body, then it's perfectly natural because that is our true nature. But as long as we identify nature with mind and body, then, you know, selfishness comes more naturally to us. So one has to, like, in any such pursuits which you call for, you know, some kind of going beyond the self, you have to create a certain power. Swami Ranganathanan used to talk of three strata of strengths or power within a human being. He used to talk of, you know, bahubal, buddhibal, that we all know. And perhaps we think that these two are the only strengths or source of power. Bahubal, physical strength in animal kingdom operates on that essentially. Okay. Then buddhibal, human beings are at that level. But even our schooling system, I think, even I remember that we were only told that human beings are different because they have intelligence, they have bahubal. They have buddhibal. Nobody talked of a third level of strength, which Swami Ranganathananda says, atmabal. He calls it atmabal or charitrabal. So he says, he gives an example that, you know, suppose like somebody is, you are in a position of power, say in government or somewhere, somebody is offering you a huge bribe and there is no chance of you getting, you know, caught. That is sure. Okay, it's very, very safe, 100% foolproof situation. Then what will enable you to say no? From where shall the power come? This question he poses to people. Okay. From where shall the strength come? It has nothing to do with bahubal, so obviously that is not there. Will it come from buddhibal? Will intelligence say? No. Intelligence cannot offer any solution in such a case. In fact, intelligence may actually, you know, put you in that direction that, okay, if there are no chances of, you know, you will think that, is there any chance of getting caught. If there is no chance, then let me. Maybe like it can actually put in that direction. Definitely not, you know, prevent you from going in that direction. So from where does this come? This comes from atmabal. Swami Ranganathananji says atmabal. And he says that this entire thing, you know, our human evolution is moving towards it. Human evolution is moving towards more and more manifestation of atmabal. And in that he, Swami Ranganathananji, he gives the example of insights from one of the greatest biologists of the last century, evolutionary biologist, Sir Julian Huxley. So some of you may have heard of Sir Julian Huxley. Okay, he was an evolutionary biologist, like in the line of Charles Darwin, etc. His grandfather was Thomas Huxley, who was a post-Darwinian figure, great post-Darwinian figure, and a family of many Nobel laureates actually. I think, you know, three members of their family were Nobel laureates. Julian Huxley wasn't a Nobel laureate, but his, you know, real brother Aldous Huxley was, and grandfather Thomas Huxley. So, Julian Huxley also says, he says that, you know, organic evolution has no use after the human stage. He says that the purpose of organic evolution was to create organs to fulfill certain functions. For example, for swimming, certain organs, certain organism developed, like fish, etc. Okay, to enable them to do swimming. Or for flying, birds develop certain organs. He said that human stage, the human being has such a tremendous organ of the brain that he can create organs externally, outside his body, for achieving these things. What we call machines. Machines are, you know, in a sense, they are organs outside the human body. For like a human being need not go through organic evolution to create, you know, wings. He can create an aeroplane. He need not wait for millions of years for that evolution to happen. He creates aeroplanes which serve that purpose, or he can create big ships to serve the purpose. He need not go through the route of, you know, evolution, which fish, etc. have gone. So all physical requirements, what was the purpose of, you know, organic evolution? Julian Huxley, Sir Julian Huxley says that's not required. He said what, then he puts this question, what is the nature of evolution after this thing? He says the evolution after this will be at an individual level, personal level, and it will be within. It doesn't have much to do with, you know, the organic part, physical part of, you know, human being. But it will be, he uses the term psychosocial evolution, wherein it feels an identification with all individuals, all beings which are there, the entire creation. And here, you know, the Vedantic overtone is very, very pronounced. Okay, this identification with the entire creation. So this, and Huxley says that till now evolution was at the species level, now it will be at the individual level. It's not that whole species will move towards that. It will be at individual level, and therefore it's up to the individual to accelerate himself or herself in that direction. And that is what we call sadhana, isn't it? Individual pursuit, it's totally on that individual, self-effort of that individual to accelerate in direction of what Julian Huxley said, psychosocial evolution, but you could say, I mean, the pursuit of tremendous freedom. Or Julian Huxley also used the term science of human possibilities. He said this is the science of human possibilities, a term Swami Ranganathananji used a lot. So this is the life of, you know, spirit of service. Service, any work, you know, government is doing service. Government bureaucrats are there, civil servants, lower bureaucracy. They also say we are doing service. Companies which are in, you know, for profit, they are saying we are doing customer service, we are a very service oriented dominant. But what we mean here when we talk of spirit of service, you all understand as being students of Swami Vivekananda, we are talking about actions, approaches which call for going beyond the smaller self. Anything, you know, in true service calls for that is based on that. It calls for selflessness. There is no other option. This line seems to be so, commonplace. I mean, a person who has not been in touch with Vivekananda, he'll think what is there. It's, millions of times we have heard it. So commonplace. Why is this the quotation, lead quotation here? Okay, he'll find it very commonplace, isn't it? But all the power is in this commonplace sentence. All the power, all the truth of, Vedanta, Vivekananda. Unselfishness, selflessness. So, Sister Nivedita, she had, designed an emblem for the country way back in 1905, when nobody had thought of anything like that. Okay, Sister Nivedita, this is, the 150th year of birth year of Sister Nivedita. You all would be knowing. Okay, just next month is her 150th birthday on 28th of October. She designed that with the symbol of Vajra, which is the thunderbolt. Okay, Vajra. And she writes, Sister Nivedita, that Vajra is the symbol of selflessness, because the story of Vajra, that Dadichit, when there was a battle between Suras and Asuras, gods and demons, then Indra approached, it was said that if somebody gives his own life and bones, own body, okay, a living person giving his body, not donation, body donation after death, living person willing to donate the body at that time, okay, at that instant, and from his bones, if an organ is, this weapon is made, that will be invincible. It was suggested to Indra and to the gods, small gods, small gods, okay, so Suras basically. So they approached Dadichi readily, accepted that, and from his body, his bones, the weapon which was made is called Vajra, okay, and it had the power of thunderbolt. Nobody could withstand that. So Swami Vivekananda was also very fond of this idea. Sister Nivedita therefore used Vajra as the national emblem. Many people at that time used it. Acharya Jagdish Chandra Bose used it. That is the emblem of the Bose Institute in Calcutta, founded by J.C. Bose. Okay. So, Sister Nivedita says, Vajra is invincible because behind that is selflessness. The whole message of Vajra is that selflessness is invincible. If you become selfless, then you are the instrument, you are the weapon of God. Nothing less than that. Nothing less than that. Okay. One has to actually feel like this. One has to have this tremendous conviction that this is true. If you are selfless, you are an instrument of God. And you are lesser instrument of God if you are, less selfless, more selfish. More selfish you are, lesser you shall be an instrument of God. You won't be used as a channel. You won't be used as an instrument. So, Swami Ranganathananda, in two short sentences he used to say, somebody asked him, what is the seva bhav, attitude of service? We keep on hearing seva bhav, this term. So he said that, having this attitude all the time, that what can I do for you? This simple question. What can I do for you? Question mark. Having this attitude all the time before everyone we come across. It could be a poor man, it could be a very rich man. We could be meeting a CEO, billionaire CEO, but still if we have this attitude, we may have something to give him, no? Okay. And a truly spiritual person always has a lot to give. Remember this. Okay. So, what can I do for you? This is exactly opposite of what is the worldly attitude, which is what can I get from you, isn't it? Swami Sarvapriyanand, gives this example. What can I get from you? This is the worldly attitude. And this is exactly opposite of, the true spiritual attitude, which is spirit of service. seva bhav, what can I do for you? So having this in all interpersonal interactions, if they have to be true interactions, engagements, otherwise they are merely transactions. Those are merely interpersonal transactions. Like we also lived in such campuses. Okay, we know. You know, there is such kind of, you know, we are conditioned to be selfish. Somehow even academic success, which brings us to such institution, does not ensure that we become less selfish. That is a very sad thing I have seen in IIT, IIM, everywhere, right? So this, it's all relationships mostly are, you know, I mean, transactional in nature. Okay, transactional in nature. They are not true relationships. So this spirit of service is in relation. Spirit of service doesn't mean you have to start an organization like this. You do not have. What's the need? Only very few people would want to, and it's not needed. I mean, how many can and why should they? So many things, the world needs all kinds of people and all kinds of occupations, all kinds of, you know, professions. Wherever you go, you can be a, Swami Ranganathananda used to say, you can be a tissue of regeneration. He says that when cancer is there in the human body, then, you know, degenerative cells start, you know, magnifying, multiplying. If a regenerative cell is there, then it can counter that. And our society, you all know, and in general, no, why ours, you know, worldwide, particularly in this, you know, tremendously fast changing materialistic age, we do not know, we sometimes do not realize at what pace this is changing and towards what direction these, all these materialistic changes, you know, in fast technology, internet, you know, all in all kind of things available, you know, good and bad. So these are like, the whole world is now a, you know, a mart of, you could say, a marketplace for, you know, Mahamaya, temptations. It was never true, never more true than in this age. In this age it has become, you know, I mean, at the highest level. We are living in a marketplace of temptations all the time. Unless we are very, very careful, we are, you know, I mean, very, very likely to slip. So many temptations are there of all nature. So, are any person who is, you know, who can act as a regenerative tissue, he does real good to the society. If you are in government, if you are a scientist, say in, you know, say ISRO or wherever, an academic in such an institution, a highly inspiring academic, you know, professor can change lives, mold lives of so many, not just academically, as persons. They as persons, they can change as persons, not just, you know, I mean, giving these, offering courses and teaching, etc. Where are such persons? Okay. So such, I think, true spirit of service therefore can be manifested anywhere. And this is what I want to, you know, before our Q&A, this would be the last thing I would want to say, that one doesn't need to start, you know, in an organization like this for doing service. Service is a universal aspect, and actually it should be the basis of all relationships. Okay. Vivekananda said that religion is the constitutional necessity of human mind. Wonderful sentence. How in such sentence he could, you know, give such great truths. That is, I think, the most special thing about Swamiji. In short, crisp sentences, he used to, you know, give such high truth. He said religion, by religion even spirituality, okay, religion is the constitutional necessity. Our minds are designed in such a way that they would want to reach the infinite. Okay, infinite. And similarly, service is the, you know, constitutional necessity actually for all human relationships to remain healthy and sound, and therefore for the society to remain healthy and sound, and for an individual's own, you know, meaningful pursuit in life, okay, which no other thing can give. What other, how can money be, you know, I'll take one more minute because this one example I always want to give, okay. So how can money be the motivator, be the, you know, only motivator in life. I always say that if the grandson of, you know, the highest, richest person in the world, when they are born, okay, say of Ambanis, etc., the day their grandsons will be born, they will be 100 times or 1,000 times more in high net worth than the, maybe the highest salary getter from IIT or IIM, right? So what whole of our life, if we are spending in that, to in the pursuit of money, what we are doing is we are merely correcting the accident of life, that we were not born in, you know, to a billionaire, but to humble middle class parents, right? And maybe to our next generation, like a relay race, a baton is, you know, pass, we want to give the baton so that our children can take a bit of lead in this race of materialism. Is this what our lives are for? Huh? Merely for making our children say, you know, in relay race a little bit ahead than we were. I rejected this pursuit because of this idea itself. Okay. I cannot spend my whole life in correcting the, you know, accident of birth that we were not, you know, born to billionaire, because children of billionaires are billionaire right from the day they are born. Okay. Each one of us is original. We have our own frequency. We need to discover our true frequency. Our frequencies have got all mixed up. Right now we do not even know what we want. In physics, you all are, you know, engineering students. In physics, we talk of, you know, superimposition of waves, isn't it? So two waves, when they overlap or superimpose versus different frequencies, then different noise gets created. This is what all of us are suffering from right now, because so many frequencies of the world, so many expectations or perceptions. Society has created norms of, you know, success and failure. They have put us before us. How many of us can say that we are here because of our own choice? 100% because of our own choice. That we took, say, mathematics and science after class 10 just because we wanted, or we appeared in IIT, you know, joint entrance or wherever, just because we wanted. No. To a very large extent, our choices were given to us. They were not our individual choices even, right? So all our frequencies are mixed up. We have to discover our own true frequency in order to arrive at what our own swabhava is, and then manifest our swabhava. That is the essence, I think, beginning of spiritual life and any, you know, life of servicefulness. You have to arrive at your swabhava with this mixed, you know, noise bag of mind which most of us have. This is very, very difficult. Okay. Now we can, I think, have our, you know, maybe 20 minutes or so, 20, 25 minutes. Yes, please. Any questions? Maybe we can have questions on, you know, on this theme only, then say the domain of my work, that I can offline also, to interested people, I can respond offline about work of my organization, you know. So here I think we can stick our question more to this theme, say servicefulness or spirit of service. Yeah. Yeah, please.
Hello. Nice inspiration, your
Thank
work
you.
And your words.
Thank you.
I just want to know that when we are convinced, but it is anyway very hard to convince ourselves to find those germs of service in us and then go on this path. How to convince the people around us who are much more difficult by their conditioning of whatever their upbringing,
no.
Our relatives, our parents, whatever.
No, so sometimes I feel that we only bring this question when it is about things like this. When we think of marrying girl of our choice, then we do not think much about this, that what will, you know, whether how difficult or easy will it be to convince our relatives or, you know. So anyway, like, thing is that if you are highly convinced, it all depends on one's own personal conviction. It is never, you know, people around us will always be fine with what we do. It's never the case. You know, you can ask so many monks who come here from the Ramakrishna order, okay, how their decisions, only in very few cases, okay, right at the initial stage, everyone is fine with that decision. Okay. or in, so it's the personal conviction which you have to grow, which any individual has to grow, and if that is strong enough, then these things do not matter in the final analysis. Actually, you would want others to, you know, get convinced, but if personal, strong personal conviction is there, then you don't have to intellectually convince. That also is the thing. Then your own strong personal conviction works its way, okay, into the minds and hearts of people around you. So your personal conviction itself has to be very strong. I would, you know, mean to this question, I can only say this. Yeah. Yeah, any other?
So in selfless service, like, there is no, we should not have expectations of anything in return. Then is only it is called a selfless service. So in case of any work which we are trying to do, like, there should be like minimum expectations which I'd be looking for in order to, from that particular work. So how do I take this?
Okay. Now this word selfless, no, this is also misunderstood also many times, or used also in many different connotations, with different connotation. Now when we say selfless, we talk of this small self, which was, you know, in this, the small, which is related to our, what we say are in Vedantic term, body mind complex, right? This small self. But otherwise it's our true self only which we are manifesting when we become selfless. We are actually arriving at our truer self, what we call, use the capital S for that, right? So small self to true self. Sometimes people ask me that, you know, mean they say that you have done sacrifice, etc. So much sacrifice. But honestly, I never felt that I have done any sacrifice, right? Because if by sacrifice it is meant, you know, giving up of things which you cherished, then definitely it's not the sacrifice. I never, you know, gave up anything which I cherished a lot, right? Like, on the contrary, I made, you know, it was more of a, what we call in Vedanta, we use this word discrimination or discernment, right? Viveka, basically. Viveka between what is my own true frequency and what are the things which others have imposed, which I have mistaken to be mine, my frequency, but actually they are not my frequency. So this Viveka between these two, that is what, you know, maybe I also did, or many others like me have done. It's not sacrifice. We have therefore separated what was not our, you know, what was not our true nature from what is our true nature, or what we would want to be our true nature. We would want to develop on those lines. Maybe it's not, you know, crystallized or strong, but we have realized that, oh, we have to move on this, move in this direction. And this feeling is there intuitively, right? It's not that, you know, I was, you know, last 15 years, I can see the kind of, you know, say, inward progress I have made. That is quite, you know, I mean, I can understand. So 15 years back, you know, it was all mixed up. But this intuitively, you feel, you know that this is the direction you have to go. So it's selflessness is about this, actually, like separating what is not your true frequency with your true frequency, and reaching your, manifesting your higher self in the process. About expectations, certain things are, you know, necessary for maintaining life, for working itself, okay. Certain needs are there. You need to stay, you need food to eat, you need clothing to wear, for, you need transportation, you have to go to far off places, etc. Or to be efficient, you need certain things. These days you need phone or even internet to be work efficient. So certain things we would not call, you know, expectation. They are, in some sense, they are required for work. Those things, obviously, like, one would want. But expectations, like, definitely not materialistic expectation, but even name and fame, one has to completely reject. Completely be careful of rejecting. That is the, I think, most important. Swami Vivekananda said that's the last frontier to be conquered. I mean, it's the, even the highest of souls, they may get caught in this Swami Vivekananda says. I'm paraphrasing what he actually said. Okay. So this one has to be careful of, because again, and I have also seen that when, you know, I mean, these kind of expectations, they may not be conscious expectation, but they lurk somewhere in your system. They are lurking like shadows, right? One has to be very conscious of not being swayed by them, because our decisions very often then are made based on that. We tend to do things which may bring us, you know, not just name, fame, appreciation by people, even appreciation by people. You know, why to be swayed by that? You know, reject, you know, notions of success as well as notions of failure given by others. I mean, I have always at least tried to practice this. When you reject notions of failure, then you also have to reject notions of success given by others. Both have to be rejected. Okay. So, it's like this. These name, fame, even appreciation, etc. Because otherwise, our subconsciously we walk in that direction which may bring that to us. I mean, subconsciously. So, we have to be very, very careful. That is very hard actually. That's not easy. Yes.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Sir, I was just having one question in mind from last some 6 months.
Yes.
So whenever I used to go out from IIT from main gate, some beggars will be sitting there, always on the street. So I always used to think, so what can I do for them? So if I give them money, I'm not sure what their money will be going to them, or some other powerful person will be coming on them and taking their money. It may be used as black money, or it can be applied to some other unuseful purpose. So, if some kid is there begging for money, so that feeling is also very bad. So on my part, what can I do for them?
Look, I think like we all face many such situations. Okay. Many such situations. When we are running an organization, then even such situations get multiplied, because anyway we come across such cases where people know we are in a position to help because we are working in that field. Look, feeling is one thing. I think pure feeling is a very important thing. Pure feeling means selfless feeling. But after that it has to be thoughtful action. Okay. Thoughtful action should follow pure feeling. Otherwise, many times, you know, it can become what Vivekananda also referred to as tamasic daan or tamasic charity. Okay. He talks of three kinds of, you know, charity: sattvic, rajasic and tamasic. He said that when you are on your impulse, because you just feel like giving, you are giving. Okay, okay. Vritti tamasic, he said. One has to be thoughtful about the patra, the recipient of, you know, that particular charity or action, etc.